Hello and welcome to the Foxy Grove podcast. I'm your host, as always, Foxy, and this is the show where we talk about topics and see where the conversation takes us. Now, I am joined today, or tonight, as it were, in lockdown by the Temple Bar bad boy, Terry Thatcher, and the former violent gentleman, now CrossFit Jesus, Frankie.
CrossFit Judas.
So how are we doing?
Yeah, it's still gone. Still gone. It's a awful depressing time.
Yes.
We're what, an hour and a half away from entering our second lockdown?
Yeah.
So because it is it's just 20 past 10. So second lockdown is coming. Third lockdown if you're in Kildare. But they should be locking that place down anyway. And build a wall around Kildare, I say.
I'm sure Justy'd be so happy to hear that.
Build a wall around Justy's house.
How many seconds are we in? How many seconds are we in? And Franz already got himself barred from Kildare.
It wouldn't be the first time someone said, "Don't come to a show here. Don't do it." But yeah, no, it's an hour and a half left. So if you want to run 6 kilometers away from your house, go for it now, lads.
Do it now.
We'll still be here recording if you get back.
We're about to enter another fucking lockdown, which is fucking shite because people can't follow a simple instruction. It's like, how hard is it to follow simple instructions? There's markings on the floor. There's also sanitizer. Wear a mask.
First and foremost,
wear a fucking mask.
Apparently that's really hard to wear a mask. Not even just wear a mask, just wear a mask properly.
Yeah.
I went and got the hair done on Monday. If they weren't wearing a mask in there, they had them down below their nose and stuff like that. And it's just, I wouldn't mind, and it wasn't even just the people coming in, it was some of the staff members as well. It was seriously, what is
doing? I understand for some people it is a pain in the hole, the complaints. Yeah. It's too hot. I can't breathe. Look, stay in the house. Don't go out if that's the way you feel, but don't be putting other people in danger because you're a dickhead. Yeah. And that's really what it is. I like to call it out. Lindsay, who is real, by the way, goes mad when I actually shout loudly when someone walks by with their nose out. I'd be like, "Oh, look at that dickhead." Just shout out.
Dick nose. Yeah,
because that's what it looks like. You wouldn't walk around with your knob outside the top of your trousers. You just wouldn't do it. So why are you doing it with your nose outside the mask? I think I've said this on every podcast I've been on. Just wear the fucking mask properly. Don't be a knob. Even if you don't believe in it. There are some people that do.
Why force on someone else? It's like, you shouldn't be wearing a mask. You shouldn't wear a mask. It's violating our freedom. What? How? We're just asking you.
It was me wearing a mask violating your freedom, kind of thing.
You're still free to do whatever you want. Well, now you're not because you didn't wear the fucking mask.
Yeah.
If
you had just copped on a few months ago, we wouldn't be in this position again.
And look, the government, whatever, I don't really like talking about politics because I don't know enough, but the government probably aren't handling it right. We're going to come out, we're going to probably go back into another one. There'll be just different rounds of lockdown coming around until we get a vaccine. But yeah, it's a bit of a pain in the arse. It's a pain in the arse that this evening was the last time all of us could step into a gym, unless you're part of that West Side gym in Blanchardstown who are staying open. And they advertised it straight out that they're staying open, so they'll be fined and closed down fairly soon, I'd say. But people need it, I think.
I didn't know that was an option.
Which is a problem because it ruins everyone saying it's a good thing. I don't think it is because the way people are trying to get this through, that gyms are essential, is by all the gyms going with it and then people fighting for it. If this lad just says, "No, I'm not going by it," now he's breaking the law, it makes it look bad. Yeah. So if that dickhead could not do that,
That it makes it harder to argue that it's essential when someone is flat out refusing to follow the guidelines.
Yeah, like follow the guidelines, and then hopefully we'll only be without for about 2 or 3 weeks until we can convince someone that this is a need. That like, to me it is. I don't know if you go to gym regularly or whatever. It's the only place I go.
I do.
Six days a week, five, six days a week. I'll be there just to do something during the day. I work at home, but yeah, I really think it's definitely essential. Anyone that's saying it's not essential, you can just run outside. It's winter now, like, or you're not going to be running outside. Mm-hmm. The amount of people that will run outside, women that will run along the canal, probably darker. The chances of something bad happening then, which is another fucking thing that you shouldn't have to worry about. But unfortunately, there's dickheads out there. It's not safe. This is not safe to do. So. Yeah, I think gyms are essential. It's very fucking quick we got into this, and me just ranting on about shit. But
I'm one of these people that like I do go to the gym, not as religiously as some others, but like I do understand the benefits of it, because I do actually feel not only physically better but mentally better coming out of a gym, because in my mind I've done something productive that I wouldn't have done at home. Yeah. I would have just sat at home, been lazy, probably eating junk. Whereas, like, coming out of a gym, I feel better about myself. And I do agree that it is an essential part for mental health.
Yeah, definitely. You always feel good. There's never a workout that you regret. It doesn't matter if it's 10 minutes, 15 minutes, whatever you can do just to get it done is always good. Fortunately, we're in a situation now where we don't have it. I do think it's going to be really, really bad. And I seen a thing there on Twitter that Varadkar said we're going to have a mental health pandemic after COVID. And it's like, if you know that, do something about it now.
Yeah.
Because you know this is happening. But
preempt. Like,
yeah, it's just ridiculous when it comes to that. But yeah, lockdown. It's going to be
Great
6 weeks. And then we're back into level 3 when we get out of this anyway. That's what I read. And so the pubs aren't open again. Can't even get a drink.
People find ways around it.
There'll always be the counter argument to the gyms is, well, yeah, can you not do things at home as well? And like, there's only so much you can do at home.
Mm.
So you can't get a proper workout unless you have like
all the equipment,
like a home gym, or you have some proper equipment at home. And obviously not everybody is able to afford that. Not everybody has the room for that.
Yeah.
So it's not always a possibility.
I'm lucky enough that my gym will give me equipment that I need. Like the last lockdown, I had a rower in the sitting room. I had dumbbells, I had kettlebells, I had basically everything I needed to get a workout in, but it's not the same. I work at home, I eat at home, I watch telly at home, I sleep at home. It's, you can't condense someone into that small space and think it's good for them. But we were lucky enough with the weather that we had during the lockdown one, where we could leave the house and go on a walk. Or right now, I just don't think you can do that safely. Like I can go run, not a problem, but like if it's in a dark area and let's say I don't have a high vis on, chance of me getting hit by a car a lot higher than they were when it was bright evens and things like that. It's just safety. Not a lot of people will follow them kind of rules. People are just like, if you're a runner, you probably know the rules that you have to go by, what you need to wear or whatever. Some people who are just amateurs at it and just going out for their 2 or 3K won't follow them rules, and it can cause issues. And it just goes further down the line when you start thinking about things like that. I just don't think working out at home, doing any kind of workouts at home, really helps anyone.
It is more the mental aspect. It's like the mental aspect of like getting up, going out and doing it, as opposed to like if your home is supposed to be a place of comfort and safety, and just it is your safety net where you don't want to do anything. It's a place of rest.
Exactly. Yeah. Now it's turned into your nightclub, your pub, your gym, your everything. Like, and yeah, it's not good for you. Like, I know myself from the start of this lockdown to now, my screen time in one day on this phone was 11 hours. I spent 11 hours of my day looking at my phone. Like, that's not good. Now we're looking at a laptop screen. I look at a laptop screen 8 hours a day for work. You're looking at your television screen. Mentally, you're just going to shut down from that. Like, I understand you have kids, so they probably take up most of your days. Like, so you don't have time or luxury to sit down and look at a phone. So
you'd be surprised how much of it I can fit in. that's the scrolling problem, or watching YouTube.
And that did you see Social Dilemma on Netflix?
No.
So Social Dilemma is basically, without spoiling it on you, it's people that used to work in the likes of Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, whatever, talk about what goes on behind the scenes and how they've basically engineered it that you will always look at your phone or look at your laptop or whatever and go back to their apps. And if you delete your Facebook now or your Twitter or your Instagram, more than likely, if a certain time goes by that you haven't logged into it, they will send you a message. They'll send you an email. They'll contact you in some way to say, you missed out on what Fran said today on Twitter. Go check it out. And then you're dragged back into it. You're like, oh, better see what he said. I probably didn't say anything interesting.
Curiosity but they killed make cat face for you.
Exactly. So it's forcing you to do it. So if you're away from it for too long, they're afraid that they're going to miss you or they're going to lose you from it, and they drag you back in. It's a brilliant documentary. You should, anybody listening, if anyone does listen to this, should watch that. It changes their mindset about it. Doesn't get you off it, because I'm still addicted to it, but it definitely makes you more aware of what you're doing.
I found, like, with the last lockdown, I started trying to watch a little bit of Netflix, and I ended up getting sucked in to the hype of people watching, like, Tiger King. I watched that. I hated it. Like, I hated it. But I couldn't keep my eyes away from it. Like, I had to watch it.
I think I watched, like, two episodes of that, and then just, like, not that I wasn't interested around. It's just, like, yeah, I've got other shit to do. No, fuck this. Fuck this noise.
Yeah, you're one of the
lucky ones
that were able to do. Yeah.
Yeah, you're the lucky one, because when I watched it, by episode 3, I was just like, I hate everyone in this. There's no redeeming qualities for any of these people. Oh. But yet, I cannot look away. I have to keep watching. Watch the series. But one show that I got into, and I'm still watching it now because I just love it, is The Chef. And that is Jon Favreau. He's the director from Iron Man.
Is this the elk where he's in, like, a mobile cooking van?
Yeah, he's traveling with his teacher, with his chef teacher, and they're going around, like, cooking different meals or, like, preparing different meals, and it's amazing to watch. Like, I love it. It's one of those, like, you just shut off, watch it, and enjoy it, and then depend on who they have on. Like, in one of the episodes, they have Robert Downey Jr. and Tom Holland. And they're just sitting there having a casual chat about, like, little stories you wouldn't hear on the set.
I like things like that when you can kind of get into them. Like,
definitely
Netflix
something
is addictive as fuck. I love Netflix. It's really, really, really good, because when it has good stuff on it, if you catch up on all the newer stuff, then you're kind of left going, what are you watching? You go back to Peep Show or The Office or whatever and just rewatch them for the 10th time. But there's some good stuff coming up on now. I think The End of the Fucking World is coming, the new series of that. If you've ever seen that, it's brilliant. Definitely watch that. What else is coming out? Cobra Kai. Someone's talking about the third series of Cobra Kai. Is that out coming soon?
It's supposed to be coming out next year.
Oh, it's next year. Okay. Yeah. What's on it now? Second series, obviously.
Yeah, the first two seasons.
So I should watch that. I said I'm going to watch that, but
like
I'm in the same boat. Because like I can't watch Ant when I go to bed because the baby's there. So I can just watch whatever on my phone. And I only have it for me TVs. I don't have Netflix on my phone. So I can only watch whatever on the telly. So I can't watch the TV when we're all in bed. Unless the baby wakes up and then like I'm giving her a bottle and I'll throw on Deadpool or whatever. Or just something just to watch while
background noise. Background noise.
And then when I come home, Lynn's at the getting box sets on Sky. So she's wiring through keeping up with the Kardashians.
Oh, which is God.
Fucking mind melting.
You do start to love Scott Disick, though.
Yes, you do.
I don't know why. Scott Disick seems to be really good.
Yeah, you do. Like, you end up finding yourself just watching it and going, like, wait, hang on, why is she doing that? Why do these hate each other now? When does he become a girl?
He actually, speaking of
Caitlyn
Jenner, she's on a series on Netflix now called The Cabin
with Bert Kreischer. Yeah.
What an episode. Like, she's brilliant on it.
I need to watch it because I like Bert Kreischer.
Yeah.
I was watching her on I'm a Celebrity last year, and she was actually really entertaining on it as well.
Yeah, I heard of it. Did she win that, or?
Did she?
I don't remember.
I think the same again. We watched it up to a certain point, and then missed a couple of nights, and then just
never caught up. Yeah. It's like you break the cycle of it, and you're like, "Oh, I'm out, and I don't have to do this anymore." Yeah, it's the Kardashians. I don't know how you're. I've done it, sat through loads of episodes of that, and I found myself doing that. Like, what's she gonna do? Like, what? And then the way they talk, like, it's this fake, like, oh my God. And they're like,
that was slow. Like, I was in the kitchen, Lynn was in the sitting room, she's watching one of the seasons, and I'm in ironing Orla's uniform for tomorrow, and I can overhear it, and I'm going, okay, which one of them is speaking now?
They all sound the same if you're not watching.
Every one of them sound exactly the same.
And I can't, like, if you put them in a lineup,
you couldn't tell them apart.
I could only say which one is Kim Kardashian and the Ma. I couldn't tell you, like, if you were like, fucking pick one out and say this name, pick it out.
Yeah, like Kylie or whoever.
Yeah, I don't know which ones. I think I know the one, Kylie. She's the young one that. A billionaire or whatever, like that, but I can't pick them out. I just get so confused. All the names, so many. Just Scott Disick, he's the only good one out of London.
There's always those shows.
I will say this as well. We're at the getting back into, we're rewatching Scrubs because I started listening to the Scrubs the podcast. Catch up
one, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, brilliant. Yeah, it's a brilliant podcast.
Brilliant. Well, yeah, it reminded me then that, like, oh, yeah, we can just, like, start watching that. We can't think of that in the watch in the evenings and showing a couple episodes of that and just end up flying through.
Definitely need to go back and watch that. Like, I'm on season 8 of Modern Family, and it's not on Netflix, so I have to wait for that to come to Netflix now. But that was one of them things where you just turn it on. I love them shows where you're like, flick that on, watch an episode. Like, I found myself doing like 7 or 8 episodes a day. I'm like, oh no, I'm addicted. It's a problem. Yeah, now Netflix is definitely something that's going to keep us all in
somewhat
line.
Sane.
For the next 6 weeks.
Hopefully,
I haven't watched wrestling.
No,
and that's a problem.
Well,
like at all, little clips
here and there.
I'll watch clips if there's a good match on a pay per view that pops up. I might turn it on. What was the last one I watched? I watched Finn Balor and
Kyle O'Reilly,
and that was the last one. But I only watched that match. I didn't watch the pay per view. Like, I just keep doing that, but I just have no interest of sitting down and watching wrestling. I'm like, oh no, do I not like wrestling anymore?
The last pay-per-view I watched was the was the last pay-per-view, not the NXT one, the one before that, the like SmackDown.
Extreme Rules or something.
Reigns versus fucking Jey Uso.
Night of Champions.
I watched Reigns versus Uso. That match again.
Fantastic.
That was absolutely fantastic. Really, really good wrestling.
Good storytelling from start to finish.
They say that was really good wrestling. They barely done anything to each other in that match. Yeah.
It was paced out so well.
Tall little story.
It was missing super kicks and Canadian destroyers. I'm just going to throw it out there. I would love to see just Owen Hour, Canadian destroyer. Done.
Best character work I've ever seen Reigns do.
This new persona. It's better than for The Rock, isn't it? It's efficient for it.
But I'm not going to deny it. I would want to see that now because Reigns is so good at the moment.
I don't know if The Rock would come back if there's not going to be a crowd.
He said he'd come back to wrestle around Reigns in an interview I think it was about a day or two after that he'd done an interview and released an interview and he said he wanted to wrestle him. So it has to be a crowd now.
Mm. Yeah.
And there will be a crowd next year for Mania. The Americans are mental.
They're just going to go ahead and do it anyway.
Yeah.
What I found that pissed me off with it is, especially with this Thunderdome, is the fact that they've only 30 people and they're copied and pasted.
Oh, they're copied around. Yeah.
It's really annoying because it's kind of like, do you know those old boomerang videos that you could do on Instagram?
Oh, yeah.
It's a 10-second clip and then it's repeating. Yeah. It's just that.
I see, that's one thing I never noticed. A few people are saying that about piped in crowd noise and stuff. I've never noticed that. One thing that never bothered me, I was like, nah, the crowd's cheering. Where's that coming from? Hold on a minute.
You know the way WWE, they do all these weird camera cuts, there's 27 camera cuts.
Oh, they're really bad for them, man.
I never noticed that until people started talking about it, and now I can't unsee it.
Yeah, sometimes they do it at the worst times as well. Edge hitting his first spear, the rumble. Camera cut.
That was the start of it. That was actually the start of it. And then people were like hawks just watching it. He's doing it there. He's switching.
Bad cameraman. That amateur cameraman that probably films fucking weddings or something. He's like, he's a bad cameraman. The fella being paid millions. Shout out, Macklin. But I love that. I love armchair criticism. It's probably one of my favorite things on the internet. It's when some lad who is just out of shape is just like, I could have done that better. That lad that done the flip over the ropes, the ricochet flip over the ropes, there was a camera cut on that. Macklin did tweet about that, but that's something that I'm about. When you go to the comments, I think that's his name.
He got injured doing it.
Okay, that makes that worse. But when you actually go to the comments of that, they're like, that wasn't even good. You didn't even stick that landing. You didn't even, and you're like, oh my God. can you touch your toes? This lad just done a flip over the ropes. That's terrifying.
Mm.
And they're all just like, yeah, no, didn't do well in that. No, it's not good. Should be signed. Go to AEW. What?
Why is it he's not good enough to be in WWE, but yeah, he's good enough to be in AEW?
Yeah, that's literally he should go to AEW. They'd never cut the camera like that. Wait, what? This doesn't make sense. Stop talking.
No, they'd watch him fall and break his leg and say, no, he's still good to go.
Yeah, he's good to go. Yeah, you have a good
speaking of that, the incident with Matt Hardy a couple of weeks back. I don't know if you've seen it. He was against
Sammy. I saw the clip. Yeah.
I went and watched that too.
It was a comedy of errors. He got hurt, and then Aubrey said, "No, he's knocked out."
He
said, "No, he's okay."
Yeah,
and then he realized afterwards that he wasn't. And then he said he said he wasn't okay, or his missus said he wasn't okay. And then fucking Tony Khan said, oh no, our doctor said he was all right. And then his missus came back and said, no, they didn't. So it was just like loads of little back and forth.
I think hard to keep up with. He done the old wrestling thing of, I need to continue.
Show must go on.
Yeah. And they weren't going to go against him. There's no way.
Anyone with a brain that's seen that fucking, like, that happen, instantly knew, like, nope.
And yeah, but where, like, if you think about that, right, you go to WWE and that happens, they'll say, call it off. 100% call that off. It's not happening. Yeah. Because they have years and years and years of behind them. And if he goes against them, they'll be like, well, you don't have a job anymore for being stupid. But AEW don't have years and years and years behind them.
Yeah.
So he's saying, fuck you, I'm grand. They're like, what do we do? Like, he's after saying he's grand, so we can't do anything about it. Yeah. And then it just unraveled into a holy shit show. But they did say he wasn't concussed. And I think it was last week I seen on Twitter that it was like, Matt Hardy's cleared to wrestle. But there was nothing wrong with him. Why is he cleared? Like,
yeah, so I thought he was okay.
Yeah. It was horrible to watch. That was really, really bad. I think fair play to him for finishing it. It's a very stupid thing to do, but...
Yeah.
Well, not fair play to him because he didn't do anything. Yeah, fair play to your man...
Guevara.
Sammy Guevara, for being able to...
He's a very good worker. He is a very good worker. I'll give him that.
Yeah. No, we're not allowed to say that about him. He's cancelled.
A lot of people are cancelled, but still...
He's not cancelled. He said something stupid and that was cleared up.
Yeah, he redeemed himself a little bit.
No, I'm not going to make fun of people being cancelled. That's even bad for me. I wouldn't do that. But that I said I didn't at the very start of this conversation that I haven't watched wrestling and anything you was mentioned there. Yeah, I've seen that, so I've watched loads of wrestling, lads. Actually,
fucking liar. You're one of those lads who comes into training on his first day. It's like, don't really like it.
I don't even really like wrestling. That's 100% me.
Who's your favorite wrestler?
Oh, John Cena. Oh, I love him. No, that was 110% me. Don't really watch that anymore, yourself, like, and then naming all the moves. And I'm like,
in regards to like with the types of trainees that you come across, like me and you, Joe, we've been in it for years, but like the amount of trainees that we come across that like are downplayer. That they fucking
because it's not cool.
Like wrestling, but it's fucking hilarious when they actually like full on mark out over the simplest fucking thing. It's literally just like, don't really watch it, and it's like I might watch this here and there, and then about half hour later they see them. Oh, he did that! Yay! Fucking so like proper jumping around the place.
Yeah, like fans in the corner watching the transition. No, like, I was that person. I'm not going to lie.
You're still that person.
I love marking out.
I think you know. Remember the Beyond the Mat guy?
Oh, God, yeah.
When he said that story, I was like, I vaguely remember him. I actually do vaguely remember it. Like,
who was this now?
He's a trainee back in IWW. We're trying to explore. I can't remember who was taking the class or whatever, but they were trying to go over like just kind of psychology and whatever. They're just teaching a class, and he kind of just says, "Oh no, like I think I get psychology now because you know I've watched Beyond the Mat."
Oh no!
Like, oh god!
Oh no!
He was one of them.
That's that's really bad. I watched Beyond the Mat. There, it's on Netflix as well. I didn't learn anything from it other than I really need to buy a trampoline.
I'm not booked, Terry.
I really want you to match. I'm not booked, Terry. That's literally my life. Like, I'm going to fall into that. Can I ref the match?
What was the logic of being like in his jocks with two bits of weights on a trampoline?
He has to stay ready.
He has to stay in shape because he doesn't know when his next match is going to be.
That's literally
had a match in like 5 years at this point.
It's literally me.
Like me.
Well, yeah, the ref.
Probably shouldn't make fun of the dead.
Ah, look.
Yeah.
We didn't.
No, he's an internet meme sensation.
He is a meme because of Beyond the Mat. Like,
he lives on through the meme.
Yeah. But the psychology of wrestling, like, I just don't understand how someone they said they can get that from Beyond the Mat. Like, when I
probably like
training,
paraphrasing or whatever, but he said something along those lines that he gets wrestling because he watched
Beyond the Mat.
Yeah, like he understands
so
that
long.
Like, at some point you will definitely be doing drugs.
Like,
because
that
you watched
happen,
Beyond the Mat.
Yeah. That's a definite. I always thought that.
So that's what you're taking from it.
I was picking my favorite painkillers out and all, like, to get addicted. I was ready when I went in. But no, it took me so long for psychology. Like, I just did not understand. I still don't. But, like, does kayfabe exist? Is that a thing that we do?
What we're doing right now is kind of kayfabe shattering.
Is it? Yeah, cool. Right,
not specifically us doing this. We're not breaking, like, we're not, like...
Should I get into character?
Motoring kayfabe right now.
Should I? Do you want me to get into character? Oh, okay, I'm in character. There was no character. Like, hold your hands up, awkwardly.
Like, shit like this. Like, you get fucking Cornette and people who, like, shit all over wrestling now because, like, there's no, like... Nobody protects the business anymore. It's like, dude, you're literally doing a fucking shoot interview talking about the behind the scenes of the business. You are, it drives me insane.
Yeah, well, that,
the hypocrisy
is
of
despite
it.
The fact that he's so fucking smart about everything. Like, he's really, like, has an incredible wrestling mind, but, like,
that's a character that he plays. The whole, you know, the wrestling is dead or whatever because super kicks and slaps. Yeah. Like, he's keeping that going. And as soon as he says, you know, that was stupid, kayfabe is dead, the internet explodes and he's back in.
And whoever he's saying about suddenly becomes a viral sensation.
Massive. Like Joey Janela, like, you know, the two of them are messaging behind the scenes, they're going, thanks very much for that. Yeah, like, and he's huge then, Joey. It's just the way it is. But the reason I asked was kayfabe dead? Because obviously talking about psychology, like, I never understood, like, Shine, Hope Spot. Like, I was like, okay, after the Hope Spot, what? Where do I go? It was like, I just have to hit him. Like, I just never got, what the fuck am I doing that for? It took me so long. I think it was a match with you that we had at Comic-Con was like, and I'd had like probably up to 100 matches at that point. And it was like with you where it was like, oh, this is how you plan a match. It was around that Comic-Con as well that I was like, this is what I do. Like, and I was able to actually do it, but it was like, and there was matches with other people on that as well, where I was like, oh, I can call a match now because I can figure out what to do,
where you are,
because there was, like, most of the time I was finishing matches after the comeback, like roll up just straight away because I just didn't know what to do after it. Like, there was no false finish, you'd never get a bit of fucking entertainment out of me. That's impossible because I just panicked so much after the comeback that I was like, roll up, get me out.
Like, for anyone else though, like, it's like everyone learns at their own pace. Like, some people take to certain aspects a lot quicker than others. I mean, all right, like, take myself and Joey for example. So Joey, naturally charismatic, naturally fucking athletically talented, whereas, like, I have to fucking work to fucking, like, get any little bit that I get. But I still got there. Like, I still learned how to work, how to fucking, like, where I lacked, I made up for in other aspects. Now, obviously, I wasn't the fucking, I wasn't most fantastic wrestler, but I found my calling in being a referee.
Yeah.
It is one of those things that a lot of people don't have the mentality to understand. It's like, because everyone goes in wanting to be a wrestler.
Yeah, the wrestler is the big thing. And you could have said even last year, I couldn't wrestle. He couldn't have got me into a ring. and said do a match because I was in bits. Like there was like not even injured. It was just body just wouldn't have been able to carry me through a match. But then this year happens and I'm literally in the best shape I could be in. Like you put me in there for bleeding 20 minutes, I'll go all day. And it's like, I can't do it now. Like now I'm like, because I even said to talk to you about refereeing. I was like, I just need to do something now. I can't wrestle anymore. Like, I'm done. And now it's like, it's just a bit of work later, you're back into that shape. But it's, but I think people come in, and you probably have seen this over the years a lot more, but people come in wanting to be the wrestler and they're like struggling to do things, but it's because they don't have the mobility to do it, or they're not in the gym or strong enough to do it. So like a squat is an absolute bit of torture for them when they first start, because they've never squatted.
They've never done any kind of exercising at all.
Yeah, it's mad. So the dream of being a wrestler just becomes torture for people. Like, obviously, it is torture because a bump is very painful. Hitting the ropes is painful. Holy shit. Like, nobody tells you that.
No.
Like, it's nearly a joke. Like, we're going to do a bit of run the ropes and you see the person walk up for the first time and you're like, oh, I can't wait. I can't wait to see what happens. As soon as they hit
the rope. You grab them the first time and you're like, oh.
Yeah, they're smart.
They're harder than I thought they would be. Okay, I'm just going to throw me back into it now for like the next 3 minutes, just running back and forth, getting out of breath and like hitting my lower back on the second rope, because you always forget that.
Just creasing.
or getting the fucking cuff just under your arm.
Right, and like, yeah, the lat's gone.
And that's when you're hitting those muscles. That's when you're hitting the buckles and like the pads are only covering this much.
Yeah, the steel just pokes out.
Bits of the cable coming out.
Oh, man.
Hard buckle. Is that the right corner? You're like, oh, shit. Yeah, it's always bad to watch. I do love, and this isn't taking a piss out of anyone around starting wrestling. Everyone should enjoy it or whatever, but I do love when someone Ric Flair hits the ropes sideways. You know, the old 80s style of hitting the ropes? And they absolutely crease themselves because the ropes like will spring you backwards. Like and you can't get your foot in if you're doing it sideways. It's always funny to watch that.
Timothy Thatcher had it right. Never hit the ropes.
Never hit the ropes. Yeah.
It doesn't make sense.
It doesn't. Really doesn't when you think about it. Like, but the ropes get you to the next place where you need to go. Like hit the ropes, fucking take it, whatever.
Like, that's the true transition. Like the ropes are the true transition to everything.
Exactly, yeah. It's feed up to the corner and you're like, what will I do when I'm in the corner?
And then I'm going to run away from you and then come back.
Yeah.
Like, not only that, like, the terminologies as well for things. Like, it took years to learn that as well.
Yeah, man.
Like, give me the Iggy. What the fuck is an Iggy?
And they're saying this to you mid-match. Yeah. Like, give me the Iggy. You're like, what the fuck are you talking about?
What the fuck are you talking about?
I don't know what to do. One thing that always terrified me was being told feed to the corner or feed to the ropes, and you're like, what the fuck do you want me to do when I get there? Like, just fucking go there. You're like, it's like you're either getting chopped or being stood on.
It's like, sell. What the fuck are you talking about? I don't know what are you talking about.
Fire up, and you're standing there like, what do you want? I don't know what you want me to do. Fire up. Okay.
Come on.
Come on. Shakes hands.
Who wants it? Yeah.
Clap, 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 clap. Uh-huh. And everyone claps with you. Like everyone does it. Everyone, when they start off a match, they do the clap. There's no one that does it better than Paddy Morrow. I hate when I see people do the clap now, because it just doesn't make sense now. When Paddy goes out and it's like over 18 show and he's like, clap, clap, and everyone follows him along. I'm like,
he has it down to a science, he does.
Yeah. Imagine you see the Young Bucks and bleeding some main event there now, wherever in New Japan, and they start doing the clap. Like, it wouldn't make sense. But Paddy Morrow could go main event New Japan tomorrow and clap, and all the Japanese lads stand up clapping with him.
But that's the thing with Paddy. Paddy gets you. He gets you invested on his entrance, because he'll come out and start falling all over the place, and you're already laughing, you're already on board with him. And then even when he gets into the ring and like he like the bell would ring and he'd suddenly get, who the fuck said that?
Yeah, clap. The
clap
thing. But that was the match he had with Callum Black, where like he like Paddy's obviously done comedy or whatever before, but Callum Black has never done that. Mm. It wasn't part of his character. Every match he had was super serious. He, you know, he's the beast or whatever. And then Paddy added a lot of comedy into it, and it just brought Callum Black from just being the he's the big lad and he's gonna come in, he's gonna fuck you up in the air.
He went from being a different just level. Another guy, basically, to there's more to him. Yeah, there's a lot more to him.
I wouldn't even say just another guy or whatever, because he was getting there, but he just took like five or six steps.
Added another dimension to
it.
Yeah, because it was his reactions to Paddy, and that's obviously like great, like for Callum Black, like the, how good he was to go with him. But that's Paddy Morrow in a ring being able to just command the whole crowd to get them to do whatever he wants to do, and then make someone else just look really, really good. Like, he should not be spiking. No offense, Paddy, but your age, you should not be spiking the way you do. But he just literally does stuff just to make people look ridiculous. Like, he posted that thing that he posts every year with Paul Tracy, where Paul. the monkey flip into the the finish. And
Paul being agile as fuck.
Yeah, like,
and then
and then he takes Paul's finish. I don't even know what he calls that. The kind of weird
snapmare driver.
Yeah, and the way he hits on that, like if I even tried that, me ankles would break, me arse would fall out. And he's just doing it, not bother to him. The punishment he's taking.
Sometimes that's the thing with Paddy. He can't help but spike bump. He's like, right, I'm gonna give you a drop toe hold, spike bump.
Exactly. It's like
shouldn't work. How the hell did you do that?
I just do it. Like, it's like the first day of wrestling training he learned: back bump, flip bump, front bump, and then spike. Like, and that was it. And nobody told him that was a joke.
Just skipped three levels and just went straight to the advance.
He's just like, yeah, do you want to take a front bump there? Boom, on the top of his head, and they're like, all right, he's doing it. He's wrestling.
Like the
now.
Clip that went out a while ago. Like, remember the dancing that was going on, and he comes in, just spikes himself for the laugh.
Yeah, was that he done? It was in. Was that the Tivoli at the Christmas thing? Or
I think so. Yeah,
it was either that or it was the stadium. It was one or the other.
If it's the stadium,
building up as if he's going to do a break dance, and then all of a sudden he's just like, "Boom, spike bump."
Boom, spike. Yeah, like nobody can do that to themselves that much and still be healthy. I don't know if he's healthy, but he's seems fine. He's definitely special. I'd say that's your next match, is it, Joey?
That's the one you
I would
want.
Love it.
I assume that's probably gonna happen.
I've
seen it being talked about on Twitter.
Joey wants a singles match with him
one day.
I've pitched a tag match with him before. And it's just
I'd love that as well. I'd love to tag with him.
I
really get along with Paddy like outside the ring anyway. So I'd love to just do more inside the ring with him. And like we had that one the triple threat with Karen as well. And that was really good. Really enjoyed it. The only time I've ever actually had a match with Paddy. But I'd love to if Scrapper had went ahead, we would have been in a tag together. In the it was me, Paddy, Maxer, and Mystery opponent against Eddie Kingston, Speedball, OJMO, and El Taurus, is it? Yeah. Big lad with horns.
Big lad with a horn. I'm sure you really want to get in the ring with that lad.
I'm sure there's plenty of people like that.
Big lad with a horn. that would have been good. You tagged him on a show in the KFC or whatever it's called.
Oh, yeah. Shit, yeah. That weird fucking...
You against Yeah, that Man's was good. End. That was
that. Weird, that was good. That was a fucking bizarre show. Just a bizarre match.
Yeah,
of just trying to plan it and I like we did the best we could.
I thought it was a really good match.
Language barriers and there's 10 of us out there, and everyone's trying to get a spot in and.
Weird yeah, comedy was, stuff happening. There was
yes,
a weird. What was the thing your man pulled out?
His cane was a magician, that turned wasn't into he? Like a yeah, turned into a bunch of flowers.
Yeah, like those mad shit.
Strange match.
That's fun though. Yeah, definitely. It looked fun. Like it looked like mad shit was going on, but it was really really good. Like, yeah, no,
Paddy, it was great for me as well because I'd been. Same again, like we were saying with Callum, like I've been doing a lot of serious matches and then to have that just this fucking mad, bizarre this match.
Shit show going on. Like,
yeah, well, let's call it what it is.
Yeah, because you had a run of serious shit over that last
I was able to have fun in that one and just not take it serious.
It'd be nice, like obviously when fucking wrestling eventually comes back, it'd be nice to actually get you to almost flex like your range
as a comedy touch.
Not so much like full on like comedy. It's just throw in like the curveball of the all right, the odd comedy match or
just a couple of ha-has here and there.
Yeah, a couple of ha-has here and there or like the Chris Masters, the random talent show where he does the peck dance. You
fight, the crazy you fucking do train it. Like you're or
singing
whatever.
Finally. Get that fucking OTT single going with you, Butch, and Debbie Keitel.
Yeah, sorry, Debbie Keitel, yeah. just record it in the middle of the show.
Yeah.
Austin style. I was The Rock used to do that, come out with the guitar. Just saying. Yeah, like, where I remember like that, like, back, because... I actually can't wait at this point for the. To come back, not like that I'm going to be booked anyway, but I do miss just even being ringside for OTT shows and stuff like that. I was supposed to wrestle up in Belfast just as the lockdown happened. I think it was like March 18th I was supposed to wrestle up in Next Generation, which was Resolution at the time. Supposed to wrestle there. So I was starting to build up, just come all the way around, hopefully eventually come down here and wrestle in Dublin, because I haven't wrestled in Dublin in, Jesus, main stage was the last time, but in an actual venue.
Yeah.
I haven't wrestled in years.
When there was venues around.
Yeah, when you actually had a venue. I'll probably hopefully get up there when wrestling does come back and we're allowed to travel into thing. Hopefully do a show up there.
Or again, maybe get you to do Cork.
I don't know. I don't think that's going to happen. I'm not going to lie. I don't know why, but yeah, I just don't think I'll be working Phoenix for some reason. I'd love to. And I did talk to the lads down there about some things that I was going to do with myself and Brad, Gunter Isaac, for anyone that. So we had some plans that myself and Brad were going to do something. When was that? I think that was January we were talking about. So, and then Brad is recovering from surgery as well. So it was when he got back, we were going to do something. But I'm not really sure. I don't know. I'd love to go down and do Phoenix and actually wrestle the way wrestling is. Because when was the last time I've never had a match the way wrestling is now. Like instead of just the lockup international. Like, you know, it was...
Just kind of going through your step by step
match.
Shine, cut off.
Yeah.
Heat, hope, double down, comeback, finish.
Finish, yeah. So I really want to get down and wrestle. Do you know who I would love to wrestle now? Anywhere. Louis.
Yeah.
Louis is... I just think he's great.
He's a good young player.
He's at the gain a load of weight.
Yeah,
he's cut the shit as well.
He's jacked. I'm like, what the fuck's going on here? So, and I'm happy that I gained weight as well, so it won't look like he's bigger than me now. So it's, but no,
not only that, like you talk about like transformations. Look at like Danny Cross, his transformation over the last like.
Did he get big too?
And that lad's always been in fucking shape.
He
got a little bit of size, but like he's kept it lean, and it's all like he's ripped as shit now.
Yeah, that's it. I thought I was doing.
He has that freakish body, kind of like a suplex machine that can't be named anymore for some reason.
And he can do backflips
compared to people.
Danny Cross can do backflips, and it pisses me off. Because you know what? It pisses me off that. Like his debut match was my last match on the same show as my last match on main stage, and I felt like a fucking cripple on that show. Like legit, like I was like, why am I even here? Like there's no point. I think I got a black eye on practice in the match. Like that's how bad it was. And this fucker comes out, and now look at him. He's so like how good he is. Like it's just some people just have that natural talent and athleticism or whatever the word is. But like I thought I had some sort of athleticism. I don't. Turns out I'm like I can do backflips.
Like you talk about like people that like just take to it naturally, and we're on the rise. I mean, like Joey, you got to face him a couple times as well, but like.
Justin Daniels.
Yeah,
it's definitely Justin Daniels. Like, yeah, like he found out there like a few weeks ago. He's like famous now or something. Like
he's TikTok famous. He's 2 million or something.
He's gonna be too big for wrestling now.
That's gonna be his gimmick.
Yeah, I don't know what TikTok. Like I know what TikTok is in terms of like its social media or whatever. But...
I have no idea. Orla keeps asking me, "Can she get a TikTok?" And I was like, "I don't know what it is. So I don't know. I don't know if you can get it."
It's apparently like videos like that you put up and people do dances and like they do all these weird dances
and
shit like
and things like that.
Yeah. I don't know. I just found out a couple of weeks ago that Justin Daniels was like mad famous on that shit. Like, and I'm like, all right, like fair play to you. Like if you're gonna make yourself a millionaire, this now's the time to do it. Like
fair play to him. Like even before like he became TikTok famous, like fucking hell of a little fucking worker.
Ah, no, he's fucking ridiculous, in the ring.
Scary talent.
Athletically, he can do so much, and like he's got some gas tank on him as well, so he can go. Like he can go for a substantial amount of time.
And that's the thing. What age is he? He's probably he's 16 or something. Like
he's about 16 now, maybe 17. Would he be 17? Yeah.
Nah, 16. So he was 15 when he like really got going. Like he would be 15 so young, when he faced you. Which is scary. It's fucking scary.
Like he wouldn't even be allowed into OTT shows back. In the day, like. It's mad that people that young like are doing it and are that good. It's obviously only good for promoters in Ireland that they have someone like that. Like
someone talked about before, and it's basically the fact that like the differences between the likes of when myself and Joey were coming up as opposed to now. I mean the fact that like what's available in terms of like the teachers and the training that's available to new trainees. They're so good after 3 months of training because they're getting fed all this information from people who are up there.
Who've been over to the big dance, who've been over to WWE or have like because independent wrestling had opened up and exploded over the past few years. People were able to travel and pick up things and then bring them back to the schools. Yeah. So not even just WWE, but like the amount of lads and ladies traveling all over the place and then bringing all that info back and saying, well, you do it over here this way. So this is what I picked up. Like, Jesus, Karen going over to Japan and coming back and teaching classes and teaching the what she taking in from over there and stuff like that. And
that's it. Like when I started, it was Neil Frenzy in a garage in Inchcore.
Mm-hmm.
And what can you learn from Neil Frenzy in a garage in Inchcore? Like, you know, in
not an awful lot.
But now it's like when I came back, it was Joe had just landed back from Florida and from an NXT contract, and it's like there's so much to learn now. It was a completely different, like I trained in CPW for probably the guts of a year, never had a match in CPW, wouldn't have been able to have a match, didn't learn how to put a match together, didn't learn anything. Came back to Joe's training and it was like, geez, it was like 3 or 4 months and I was on shows like, and I could do it, like I could do it to the standard it was at then. Like, and then there's these lads that are coming in now, like, and they have more than hype, who are everywhere last year.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
Martina, who was signed to Ring of Honor, Japan, fucking WWE bleeding contracts offered, like the whole thing.
Like, she had selection. It wasn't just one place and that's it. No, she had the option.
Like,
to go to
these
places.
Like, she is, like, at that level now where you're, like, she's at the level of people that are in NXT or whatever. Like, and now she's a coach in the Irish School of Wrestling, which it didn't happen yet. But she is a coach there now. Someone coming in is learning off her. Like, that is mental, like, to think.
It is.
Like,
it is.
Like, Joe was the only one that had experience, realistically. But even back 4 or 5 years ago, like he was not that he was the only one that has experience. Obviously, Maxer used to come back from Japan and take classes.
Maxer, Paul, Phil, like a lot of lads that came from the NWA Ireland Fight Factory, like they had been traveled around like the world, had this experience, but not to the degree like now where there's younger lads going there and they're able to pick it up so fast.
Yeah.
It's like,
but like even then, like the Japanese style or that kind of hard hitting fast indie style or whatever wasn't around. So Joe coming back from WWE and teaching the way WWE wanted, that was the style of wrestling everyone was doing. So like even when Max had come back and teach them things, that was a lot quicker and it was like, oh shit, there's a wrist lock and you put your foot up in the air. And
you say like Joe coming back from NXT and that's what they wanted then, but because wrestling is evolving like constantly, like, and Joe would probably say it as well, like what he was taught then is probably like give it 5 years is starting to become obsolete. It's like it's changed and it's evolved and now they're looking for something else. But like, you know, I'll always take Joe's word on things anyway, but like
obviously and most of us would. Most of us would in terms of what he's seen and he obviously he's like it's his job to know what's going on, so he's very intelligent when it comes to that stuff. But there's so much more to learn out there that we have access to. That's the mental thing. It's not that like we have to travel for it. It's there now. It's right
at our fingertips. Yeah.
You want to know something, you can literally pick up your phone now and message Martina and just be like, hey, what's the story with this? And you get an answer straight away. Like, well, probably not straight away, but like you'll get an answer.
If she answers at all.
Well, I don't know about you, Foxy. I'll get an answer straight away. But yeah, no, that's the mad thing. Or you can like ping Lee or someone like that and they've done it. They've worked for them big companies. They were literally stepping into what probably would have been a tryout. I don't know if they're too young or whatever, but they would have got it, like I assume.
They definitely would have gotten it, and they still would get it.
Yeah. Like, you'd be mad not to sign Darren Carney. Look at him. Like, it's painful to look in the mirror after watching him. He is. He's very, very handsome. But that I just find it mad the way things evolved. Like in wrestling, like in Ireland alone.
Yeah.
Like there's so much coming up.
Like even saying that, like like just even saying like how much wrestling has evolved just even over here. And like that's again talking about guys traveling over and walking different places and training different places, and like that's so vastly different from when myself and Foxy were coming in, that like we couldn't talk to the other school, let alone go train with them.
Yeah.
So like there was so much more, like obviously up until fucking the world shut down, like there was a unity between skills and between different promotions, and everyone wanted to work together as opposed to protect their one little patch of land and say, no, this is air land, this is air territory. It's like, fuck's sake, lads, like
it's not the 80s,
small country, there was no choice but to start working together to try and make it better.
Yeah, that's obviously like this, not this year obviously, but the last couple of years, when you know it was really when Fight Factory closed their Bray school
and moved to Dublin,
and moved to Dublin when they didn't have a school, and the lads from Fight Factory came to Mainstage,
were forced to start coming to Mainstage, forced to start integrating.
To come down and I'm not saying they didn't integrate and it was their fault they were over there.
If something's on your doorstep, you have the option of traveling out, you're most likely you're gonna take the closer option. So like if I'm here in Clondalkin, yeah. Spoiler, I'm not actually from Temple Bar. I'm living here in Clondalkin, and I have the option to go to Inchicore or getting a bus to travel to town and then getting a train to travel to Bray.
Yeah.
And then try and find the skill then. I'm gonna take the Inchicore bit.
Yeah.
Because it's easier for me to get there, and I can go straight from walk or whatever it is.
Obviously you're always going to go for the most convenient thing. It's sometimes not the best. There are some people that probably had a shit show going to certain skills and things like that, or certain trainers, but it's I found when the Fight Factory school closed in Bray, I don't know if it closed down or shut down or what way it worked, but and then Contenders happened, and it was like that's when everyone was like pushed to be like, everyone was supportive, like where it was like, yeah, hope you do well. But there was that thing, especially on that Contenders seminar, where it was like, yeah, I hope you do well, but I want to
the people from up north, because it was it was an actual it was kind of a competition as well.
So yeah, it was hard.
There was only so many spots they were gonna give out.
Yeah, it was that was tough. Like, but then that continued on. Then that everyone kind of built. Like I would never talk to someone in Fight Factory because I just didn't know who they were. I didn't know them personally. So I try, like even now, like I don't realistically ever talk to any of the Morden Hype boys. Just that's them as an example. Like I'll say hello, I'll shake the hands, and how are you or whatever. But
handshaking.
Well, no, bump the elbow and touch the foot and whatever weird thing we're doing in wrestling now. But like, and I think I always assume that I'm coming off a road that I don't kind of make an effort, but it's just generally me not like, I'll just leave you to it and just wander off. And I'm 30, like these lads are way younger than me. And I'm like, oh, sorry, lads, for bothering this. But that's the way I always feel. So I probably wouldn't venture to Fight Factory or whatever. Obviously I messaged you about going down, but that was obviously didn't happen. But I felt like it kind of that them moving closer and being forced to come down to us kind of took the separation away, if that makes sense.
It bridged it.
Like it didn't, like, well, it probably did make some people best friends or whatever, like, and people met new friends or whatever, but I think that was really good for the likes of OTT, because they obviously got, like, LJ was bleeding gender neutral champion within an hour, I think, of him walking into main stage, like, and like eventually Morden Hype will be tag team champions, It's like an ongoing bleeding joke at this point. Them lads and them belts, like, just give them to them, post them to them now so they can take them. But yeah, no, it's like, I think it's probably one of the best things that happened, as much as probably kills them that they lost their school in Bray or whatever. But they have a school now anyway. So,
like, with the whole thing with Bray, like, I think it was a case of, like, they were looking to move, but obviously they didn't have a location finalized. So it worked out really handy because for a couple of weeks, there was no school for the lads from Bray. So they had no choice but to start mingling with people from Dublin, which helped. Because the time when Main Stage decided, like, to pack in its doors, there was a couple of weeks where there was no school in Dublin. But Fight Factory had opened up their school. So a lot of Main Stage lads started going to Fight Factory, and therefore it just continued. Yeah. They kept going on with the almost like a symbiotic kind of thing. We helped out the other because they helped us kind of thing.
Yeah, so that's it. And I don't know if it's happening. Well, obviously not now because we're in lockdown, but
yeah,
I don't know if lads were going over there now that the Irish School of Wrestling is closed, or I hope they were.
I hope so.
Be nice to keep lads training, but
I had planned to. I was gonna see if I could get a spot in, but it's very when after the fourth lockdown and everything was starting to slowly open back up, and Fight Factory opened up their doors, they're only taking in limited amount of people.
Yeah.
I was hoping to get in for just a class here or there, if there was spots available, but their regular crew would always be they'd have days
priority. But,
that was one thing I
had messaged Katie about going down. It was okay to, and she was very nice about it, obviously said anyone's welcome, but it was one of them things. I just didn't want to disrupt their original crew.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna walk in the door and believe Michael May can't get a class with something that he helped build. You know, yeah. Right? I'm sure that would never happen, but it was just something that was in my head and being very anxious. I was like, oh no, not doing that. And it is, even though we know, you know them a lot better than me, but even though I do know these people, I still get really nervous walking in somewhere new. So I'm one of them people, I need to go somewhere else.
I know the feeling, man.
Yeah, that's the nerve-wracking part of it. You just get real anxious walking in somewhere new, don't you?
I'm really, really fucking, socially awkward. I'm a lot funnier on Twitter than I am in real life.
I think I think social media, everyone is a bit more out there.
But yeah, no, I have those awful things where I'll be having a conversation with someone and somebody will make a joke and I'll laugh and then I'll just be thinking to myself, do I even get that joke? Just laugh anyway.
Yeah, do it.
I'll be at home and I'll just go oh man, I should have said that. Why didn't I say that?
I have a comeback.
Don't text them now and say it.
You'll just think it's awkward.
Or if someone you don't know messages you, that's one thing that I always get. If someone I don't really know, I'm not that close to it, sends me a message on Instagram, Facebook, whatever, and I write a reply, I reread it, delete the reply, go again. I'm like, I have to get this perfect. But if Lindsay texts me, she's real. If she texts me, I wouldn't even think about the reply. I'd just be like, send whatever. It doesn't matter. But someone new, I just I don't want them to think I'm a freak. And then accidentally add an X at the end of it. You're like, oh no, life's over.
You're typing it out and you start realizing, oh shit, they can see the three dots. So they know I'm taking ages to write this. Yeah, and all I'm going to write back is, yeah, fine, thanks.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
Yeah, oh, the anxiety of the whole thing. It is one of them things. It's really nerve-wracking. going to new skills and hopefully, I don't know if there's any word on it because I haven't heard anything. Hopefully Joe gets a school if that's his plan.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Hopefully he gets it not only in Dublin but also in Belfast as well. I mean, like, that is the plan.
Yeah, yeah. I really hope them lads get somewhere to work, especially, and I think I've said this in every podcast, The View, Stephen Carvell. I just want him to work everywhere.
Yeah, I want him to work everywhere.
You should be. I really hope he does. That's another one I really want to wrestle him. Probably won't get that chance, I don't think.
I've said it since day one. It's just like, I want to, I would love to wrestle him. Like, to come back and I'd pull him up, make him look like the best thing ever. Like, I may not know how to do a lot of things, but I know how to fucking put people over when you get me.
Yeah, that's the thing. I he just deserves it. Yeah. I think he's just
put so a lot goddamn of nice. I love him.
I love him.
It is, it's like, we come across a lot of lads that, like, they're so goddamn nice that it's like you want to go out your way to help them. Like, even if it's just like a look in, it's like, look, I've sent the message, just be ready in the next couple of weeks. You might get a message from this guy about possibly coming in for training or otherwise. But things like that, it's just, goddamn it. Like,
yeah, I don't have that kind of pull. I'd message somebody like, you need to look this fella, like, Fran says this fella's good, he's shit. It's like, ah, for fuck's sake. Like, or they'd be like, yeah, book him, don't book Fran.
I'm lucky.
I don't have that kind of pull. I just have like friendly bits of advice, or like, will you watch me match? Yeah, of course. Like, get sent like, a few of the boys have sent me matches and asked me, just like, can I get a bit of feedback on this? And I was like, of course. I unintentionally go into like a massive, like, kind of detail, and not like ripping the piss out of it, just like, here's what did good, here's what was really good.
You should have used this hair gel.
Maybe work on, maybe do it this way, maybe take that spot instead of doing it there, maybe move it back to here, or move this to over there, maybe. You know, just little things like that. But I do get that as well. Back again, back to the weird social anxiety. When, you know, we'd be doing school sessions at the school, or we'd be watching back some of the shows, and wait, does anyone else have any feedback? And I'd always feel like I'd have something in my head that, like stuff that I'd noticed throughout matches, and I'd want to say, and then somebody else would raise their hand, and it's, okay, I'll just wait.
Yeah. I don't feel like I should.
And then by the time anyone else got any feedback,
you forgot it.
It's not even so much that I forgot it. It's just like, oh, well, everyone else is already at the same loads of things, and it kind of contradicts what I'm at the same. By that time, they've moved on to the same. They've moved on to the next match.
I'm the exact same. I'm really the exact same. It's that awkwardness of like, oh, and then everyone's looking at me, which is really weird, because I've no problem going out and wrestling in my pants. That I don't mind people looking at me in that way, or speaking, or like, my job is to speak in front of people. It's more like, literally my job is to public speak, like, and I have no problem with that, but in a small little environment with people you know, or people that you're familiar with, I'm like, oh, I can't say that. What if they think I'm stupid? It's like, no, you literally, like, I've done it for, like, I'm 6 years in wrestling, like, 7 if you go all the way back 10 years, take that one, bring it over, and do a bit of maths. But, like, I think it's 6 years, six and a half years. And I'm like, I do know things. Like, I know things and I can say things. We always have that fear of, like, you're a trainee. I'm like, yeah, technically, but like, when I started, you were 5 years and you weren't a trainee, but don't I? And I'm like, I should be allowed to say things. And
you can teach experience.
It's an open forum as well. Like, if you're in that position, like, it is, like, Joe's offering an open forum. Like, if anyone has any feedback. We all just watch the same match, so but it's just you get in your own head, and even then, when I do pluck up the courage to actually say something, I keep like not wanting to offend who I'm
speaking, because wrestlers are sensitive.
Wrestlers are very sensitive. You were really great, and I think you did this really well. Like, you did it great, but maybe do it like just an idea. Maybe do it this way, and just
But you don't have to listen. You were great. We should all
just my opinion.
We should all take a leaf out of Joe's books and just be blunt. Like, who the fuck is Fran Bork? Literally a quote from Joe Gray's mouth in front of you, Joe. You the fuck is Fran Bork? That haunted me. I don't think he'll even... That's one thing I don't think he'll ever even remember saying to me. And I don't think he even meant it in a really bad way. But fuck, that haunted me for weeks. Still does. Like, that's probably a year or two later now and I'm still saying it. But... yeah, I think sometimes you do need to be blunt, but you need to have the confidence to be bluntly about certain things. Like I've done it a few times where I've seen someone do something mental and I'm like, that's not going to work. I'm just going to outright tell you, like, no, it's not happening. Or if I'm in a match and someone says, I want to do this, I'd be like, no, you're not doing it. Like, find someone else to do it, but it's not going to be me. Like, because I do find that you're a lot, and I've wrestled more younger people. For some reason, any match that I get, it's always someone who has about a month's experience or whatever, or one match, and they're going in, I'm wrestling with them, and they always come out with that they want to do, and this isn't being bad on anyone, they all want to do some mad indie spot.
Because you when you're that young and you're that new into it, you have this in your head where it's like, well, a big move will get me over. No, a big move will get you a pop.
Yeah, pops.
It'll get you...
Gifts are getting you over. Yeah. That's what it is.
Well, like, it won't... Like, 3 seconds out of a 10-minute match isn't gonna... It's not sustainable. Like,
that's it. If you can't do the home match like that...
Yeah.
And that's one thing. And that's one of the reasons that I think...
You get over from being consistent.
Yeah, consistently providing good matches. Like, you probably, like, in all honesty, I was going to say Terry, but I want to call you Joey, and it's really awkward. Like, can you say at the start of OTT, Tivoli days, you were over? I wouldn't say you were. Like, Terry Tatro, or you had heat because you're skinhead, and we already...
Like the video, the intro, the little vignette that they did for me at the start, I thought was really cool.
Yeah,
I thought it looked really cool. The music, the presentation was interesting, was really cool looking, and I love doing my entrance of just like storming down to the ring. Now, the only problem was that, like, I'd get down to the ring before the chorus of the song would kick in. And it was just like...
Timing.
Oh, yeah.
And that's because the Tivoli had that tiny little walk to the ring. It's basically you just take one step. But the reason I'm saying that do you think you're over? I think when you went contenders, Terry Thatcher, which is a complete 180 of what the character was, there was consistent... matches all the way up to the point where everyone was like, he's here, like, this is him, like, what the skinhead wasn't, this is the real one, because you were consistently doing those things.
I think
that's it. Like, you're dead right about consistency as well, because, like, when I first started as skinhead, I had like one show and then I missed the next show, and then I was on the next show, and for some reason I was heel at the start and babyface later on because I had two separate matches, and then the next show after that I was
wrestling Jake O'Brien for no reason.
I wore Bruiser then in one of them as well, and I was back to being a heel, and then the next show me and Bruiser were tagging, so there was a lot of inconsistencies as well.
It's like, what's this lad doing here?
A lot of that was down to was me, because I was missing shows and I was missing training. And you know, Joe wasn't putting, like, if you're not putting the work in, I'm not putting you on the show. And I wasn't putting the work in. I wasn't contributing to flyering or making myself available to go out and do posters. So, like, again, like, he'd every right to keep me off shows. And unfortunately, it did kind of curtail whatever plans were in place for the skinhead gimmick. And
yeah, plus, but see, that's probably a good thing.
Yeah, like, it worked out in the end. But just took a lot longer. But not advocating, you know, be a lazy bastard around. Like,
been there. I don't know if this is going up on video, but I'm putting my hand up there. Yeah, I've done that. I've done everything you said, Joey. So you're saying I'm going to be booked?
Yeah. Just stick around. Eventually, like, your shot will come where you'll get to have like a decent match and just go, all right. Oh, Fran Bork. Oh, now I remember.
He's frozen. Oh. What a face to fucking freeze on. But obviously because two seconds. He's trying to get back in.
And he's left the room.
There we go. You can see his face now. But like, to go back to what you're saying is the fact that, like, I think it was a case of, like,
being two friends.
Yeah.
Was there two of me? Was there?
Yeah.
Sorry.
But I think it was a case of, like, you became more comfortable in what you were presenting. So therefore, that's how people could actually see how good you were. As opposed to with the skinhead, it was something that, yes, you probably might have liked it at first, but obviously that kind of character does have a shelf life, unfortunately, like, given what it was.
Unless you're going to go all in on it, then...
Yeah, which is not something that...
I don't think you probably should do, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Like, it just can only go so far unless you're going to go...
All in with.
So far.
Yeah.
Yeah, which it probably wasn't the time to do that. But it's
there was a lot of things going on back then that would definitely not fly nowadays.
Oh yeah, plenty. And this is where we get to the part where I lose my shit. And that was mentioned on a separate podcast, which I won't name.
Uh-huh.
I'm gonna talk about that and because I'm not gonna get booked anyway. But that podcast that went on that rant about that company, and I'm not going to name anyone here because everyone's going to know if they do listen to this, who I'm talking about, went too far.
Yeah.
In terms of, yes, yeah, bad things have happened. Yes, the way it was dealt with wasn't good. Just wasn't. Like, and that's, I'm very much loyal to OTT. I've been there from the very start of OTT. And I've never been treated badly by anyone that manages it, basically. But the thing that pissed me off was, if you're gonna go back and pull things from shows, mainly one of them,
like, six years ago.
Yeah, mainly one of them being the Fabulous Nikki's gimmick at the very start of OTT, which would be considered now, it's
very inappropriate.
It's not the best thing to do, obviously, now. But then, and this isn't me saying being homophobic 5 years ago was a good thing or anything like that. It's not me saying that. But it was a character that he portrayed, and the crowd made them chants. I'm not saying the crowd are okay. The suckers, chants. But you can't pull that.
It was played
back
as
up.
A joke, and everyone was in on it.
Yeah, it was a joke that everyone was in on. Everyone knew that Connor is not gay, and I think at one point he laid one on you, Foxy, and there was comments about that being he forced himself on you, and like things like that, like I just don't think you can bring up those things. And isn't me saying anything negative about anyone who's had issues with things like that in the past, or like, I'm not saying you can't bring up a bad thing that happened to you 5 years ago, because you can. No. But I really don't think the context that was said in was right, because like, your gimmick, Joey, and you apologize for your gimmick at the very start of the speaking out. You came out and said, I did this and I apologize. And that was fair play to you. That was your stance on it. In my personal opinion, I don't feel like you would need to, because one, you weren't portraying a racist. Like, I don't think you did anything racist.
It might have been perceived.
It might have been perceived as that, exactly. And that's another thing, you know, the Conor gimmick that I'm talking about now could have been perceived as homophobic. But at that time, indubitably, that crowd were very much knew the joke. Like, not knew the joke, because I don't want to say him being gay was the joke. There was never any mention of Nicky being gay. Ever.
No. Yeah. It was...
There was never like mention.
Never or whatever.
Or... Yeah, it was something like that. But I just don't think... I think if you're offended by it, yeah, that 100% you have all the right to be offended by whatever you want to be offended by. But I think in the context of that podcast and that rant that went on, I think that shouldn't have been brought up. Because it's not the same as something in the speaking out movement in terms of something that has went on now, generally, like, or has been going on and has been put out. I just think that's putting someone's name into this that shouldn't have been in it. And that's Conor doing the fabulous Nicky gimmick. Shouldn't have been put into it, because at the time he did no wrong. It was a thing that everyone was in on. Him kissing you, Foxy, was something that you probably didn't know he was going to do, but they probably didn't bother you that much, because knew who he was and
so
it wasn't
the way malicious. I see it. Like, the way I see it is that, like, with that, it was a character that everyone was in on a joke, but also you had a very good talent in Conor that was able to make, he was kind of like, all right, a good example is Be Cool in recent memory. That's a, like, the character that he's portraying was, like, very close. Like, he has to balance on a very thin line between being unbelievably, like, offensive.
Yeah.
But somehow is able to make you in on the joke and still make you find him endearing.
But that was brought up, too, in this rant. A promo that he done with someone else and basically took the piss out of that person being against something else, which is seen as he's taking the piss out of that. Everyone's taking the piss out of this, and they're like, the OTT, and this is literally putting anyone involved in OTT into this. It's like, they're all against this. I don't decide who I'm going to work with on their political views. That's just me. I don't know about yourselves, but I don't agree with Joe's political views. He doesn't agree with mine. That's fine. Nobody asked that. You know, I don't buy a ticket to see a band. Or maybe I would, because I wouldn't go see some dickhead that beats women or anything like that. But like, on their political views, I didn't ask, you know, John Mayer, did he vote for Trump the last time I went to see him, because I don't like Trump and I wouldn't buy a ticket if he did. Do you know what I mean? I think when it comes to entertainment, you don't buy a ticket because you agree with the promoter's political views. Do you know, I feel like that.
Buy a ticket to a show because you like what is being presented.
The product.
Yes.
The product. Do you know what I mean? Like Harry Potter. That sounds weird in a transition, but Harry Potter is a brilliant film series, probably a brilliant book. I can't read, didn't read it, but it's probably really good.
Did you learn to read?
Yeah, barely. I just know I physically can't sit down and read a book. It bores me. But they're brilliant books and films and things like that. J.K. Rowling is a cunt. there's no other way of saying it. Like, she's against trans people as far as I know, and she doesn't believe in it. You don't believe in something that's in front. That's just ridiculous. But do you know what I mean? But I'll still watch Harry Potter because it's really fucking good. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's just how it is. So the same way, I don't know. I think I'm probably speaking out of school here completely, but I just think that rant was putting things in a wrong way. When
it was skewing them in a way. It was unnecessary.
I understand that people have been hurt over things that have happened and the way things were handled. I completely understand. I sympathize with them completely. I hope that everything was sorted with them, but I don't believe jumping on it that way was the right thing to do. I do believe that the person that was involved in that speaking out was the right thing to do, 100%. But I just don't think doing that, ranting. So here's me saying, I don't think ranting on a podcast about it was the best thing to do while I rant on a podcast.
The irony
so,
there.
Yeah, two wrongs don't make a right. I'm not educated enough to speak on it, but I did anyway.
Obviously, like, you went on the rant for that, but, like, I get where you're going with it. It's the fact that, like, okay, here's a great example. Music. There is plenty of people who are regarded as being the best at what they do, but in their personal life have done very questionable or horrific things. I mean, look at Michael Jackson. Michael Jackson is regarded as a fucking amazing, like, entertainer and songwriter. But his personal life, he has been accused many times of potentially, like,
child abuse.
Freddie Mercury, excellent singer, excellent fucking songwriter, still made questionable, like, there was questionable, like, accusations of his personal life, of what he did or what he didn't do. But yet he's still kind of heavily played. But yet you get the example of a Gary Glitter.
Well, no.
Let me finish. You get the example of like Gary Glitter, who has some good songs, was very popular at one point.
He was not on their level.
At one point, I'm just giving you like examples of it. It's like, but certain people, like, even
he was found guilty as well.
Yeah, he was found guilty, and that's why. But with those, you see the examples. The fact that, like, right, these lads, their music is still played. Yeah, this guy still did questionable things, but his music is not played
because he was found guilty.
He was a proven wronging.
Yeah.
These were an accused wronging.
Yeah, an accused is different from proven.
True. George Michael. George Michael was proven to be doing very bad things. But yet, his songs are still played.
Oh, Last Christmas is a banger.
Do you see what I mean? Like, it is one of those things.
Yeah, there's a separation between the person and the art.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah.
Now, saying that,
people choose to remember the good part of it as opposed to the bad.
Yeah, but saying that, like, I'm not going to turn on the David Starr match tomorrow and be like, it's fucking so good, though, isn't he? It's not. It's not the same because you're talking about someone who's this level and they're talking about a cunt. And you push the cunt to the side, you know, and they did no longer deserve that recognition. But jump off. Can we jump off the thing?
Yes,
I feel like I'm gonna say something here that will get me in trouble now because
we should jump off this because it's a very volatile kind of subject.
Yeah, I definitely get angry about that.
It's one poke in the wrong direction, and then it's just
anything could be taken in the wrong context, and just like,
And if I did say anything over the last couple of minutes that you don't agree with, and that maybe would have been miseducated, I have no problem with you messaging me and saying that was wrong and explain to me what yeah. I could have done
and
better.
And opening up because, a dialogue about it then.
Yeah, I don't want to be jumped on because I said something wrong. I've already admitted a million times on this that I'm not 100% educated on this shit. I don't know.
And it's, there's just been so much of that lately that I just...
Yeah, it's not good. It's not good for anyone. It's not good for the person that's getting jumped on or the people jumping on, because that's where you're... If you're putting all your energy into having an argument on Twitter, you're doing something wrong with your day. Like, you should be working
on... You're misplacing that energy.
Yeah. You paint something.
Put to better use.
Yeah, you should definitely be putting it to better use. Like,
that goes
back to the mental health conversation that we were kind of having at the start about lockdown. Do you know, like, again, what I was saying about me spending probably 11, 12 hours on a phone all day, like, that's not good for anybody. Like, if you are listening to this and you have that addiction of your phone, put it down. Like, do something without it for 2 or 3 hours. Set a lock timer. That's what I'm going to do from tomorrow, because I said I'd do it for the lockdown. Put a lock timer on my phone where I can only receive phone calls or messages. So that means if someone does need to contact me, I can actually answer. But I don't want social media I might give it an hour or two at night. But just do something for your own mental health. If you're worried about the gym closing and you're worried about your mental health, take less time on your phone and spend some time thinking about yourself a little bit. Like, it's because it's painful to sit there and argue with someone on Twitter, and you'll never win an argument on Twitter. Even if you think you're winning, you're not, because you're arguing on Twitter. Like, it's the honest opinion of it. You're just throwing shit at a wall. That's literally all you're doing. Like, you're no more intelligent than the next person because you're literally arguing on Twitter.
You've fallen into the trap.
Yeah, it's a trap. And now you're spending more time on it because you posted something and you're arguing with someone. Now you're waiting for them to reply and
that's going back and checking every few minutes.
Yeah,
and
refreshing the page. Fuck me. You're gonna spend hours on that. Just that's the only, like, I'm not a mental health expert, but I know what fucks me up. And what fucks me up is social media and being on it for too long. Doesn't make me feel good. So try that. Just try it. It's definitely worth doing. And if you do, I'm not saying if you have a problem to not go onto Twitter and message one of your friends about it, do that. If you are feeling like you need to talk to someone, open the phone up and throw anyone a message.
Yeah.
You can. Because there's too much of that shit going on there where nobody's talking about shit.
I found that when it came time for the speaking out movement, it was a case of like, okay, I didn't want to be sitting there and just looking at screens. I actually opened up a dialogue with yourselves.
Yeah.
Because I needed to fucking process this. And I needed someone to kind of hear my thoughts. And then actually, like, be okay, grand, I know where I am now. I'm not gonna like just jump on the bandwagon. It's like, I hate this, you shouldn't have done this. But
that's the best thing to do.
Very easy to fall into that trap.
It's the best thing to do if you're feeling some weird way about something, message someone else about it. Don't sit there and wallow in it, because then what basically happens with that is you're taking that thought, you think about it, and then you're getting this like a spider web of. Yeah, it's like a spider web of different thoughts that makes something bigger than it actually is. Where someone, like, if I message one of you and say, what do you think about this? And you explain it to me, I'll go, oh, it's not that much of a big deal as I thought it was. You know what I mean? It makes me feel a little bit better.
You get to just have that little back and forth. Whereas, like you said, if you throw that up on an open forum like Twitter, then you're gonna have just so many different opinions coming in, and you're gonna have so many, like, and even if you're getting like the majority are on your side, you're gonna get negative feedback then as well.
Yeah, like if you say you like milk chocolate,
you hear all these like a lot of these YouTubers will talk about it, these wrestling YouTubers I've been listening to a lot, like, and they'll say don't ever go and read your comments, because you can get all the great video, you suck.
One bad one.
That's it. You can get 99 out of 100 good comments, and then one negative one is it fucks your day up then.
Yeah, and we do that all the time. I think humans just do that all the time, where it's that one bad thing, like when you're saying goodbye thanks goodbye to the shopkeeper, and then you end up saying tub boy canks, and you mix up your words, you're like, oh my god, I can't believe I did that, and that's with you for hours, because that one bad thing you did made you look stupid.
We always dwell on the bad things. We remember the bad things more than we do the good.
Yeah, because you skip over all the good stuff and people do, and that's what Twitter is. It's a cesspool of bad things, because you, like I was going to say there when you were talking, Joe, if you say I like milk chocolate on Twitter, someone's going to come along and say, well, dark chocolate's better. And then the next person's going to argue with that person. You're going to still be tagged in it all the way down. Now you're just reading shit. Your mind doesn't grow from that. Like you're just sticking yourself in a bubble of the same shit every day. Every single day is the same shit, especially if you sit there on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, Snapchat, TikTok, whatever you're doing, and RTE News. I do that all day too. TikTok. I don't know. Like, people are talking about this TikTok thing, and they're like, it's very funny, and I'll spend loads of time on it. Mind numbing. It has to be mind numbing to sit there. No, I don't know. This is no offense to Justin Daniels. He's probably doing a great job. Probably making money. I don't give a fuck whatever you do to make money, but it has to be mind numbing to sit there and watch three or four second videos about someone doing a dance. They're doing this weird dance and shit. I don't know where they're getting them from, but it can't be good for you. Like, it just can't be. Listen to a podcast, an audio book. Get Audible. Get a free book the first month. Take you months to read or listen to the book, but.
So Fran's gone full on old man yells at cloud.
I am because I'm I'm in that position.
That's a peddling.
These kids. I am because I'm in that position where I'm stuck to my phone constantly. Yeah. Like I'm in that, and I'm like, oh my god, my mind is being drained. Like, that's why I was complaining about the gym earlier on, that I want to stay open, because the hour a day where I don't look at my phone and the rest of it, I am looking at my phone. If you think at the time I wake up in the morning and the time I go to bed, I am on my phone for all of them. Like 11 hours in one day is a long time to be on the phone. Do you know what I mean? And that's what's fucking me up. Big time, like really messing with me. So I'm like trying to actively now take that time away from it. And I think people, and if you're going to do it, bit of advice, if you're going to take time away from Twitter, don't fucking post that you're going to take time away from Twitter. You look like a dickhead. And you know what that does? Your post that you're going to take time away from Twitter gets likes, it gets retweets, it gets comments. And what happens when you get them three? You go back. If I get a notification that says Terry Thatcher or @thatched like your tweet, I know he liked it. But I'll go on and just double check if he did. Because if he unliked it, I ain't going to be pissed off then. So now you're opening your phone. So don't post on Twitter that you're going on a break from Twitter, because you're going to get replies on that and you're going to check Twitter. And then he gets sucked right back in. Sorry. Fucking hell.
There you go.
If we're listening to that in earphones, I apologize. I probably got really loud there.
Therapy.
Yeah. This is it. We'll do this every week. I'm gonna get a podcast microphone in the new house.
And this is set an up audio intervention studio. For Fran.
That's a good name. That's a good name for a podcast.
the audio intervention. Yeah, thank you. That's mine.
You're welcome.
And I will take that.
You're welcome. I found that like during lockdown, like if I'm not with the kids, then it's basically I'm either focusing on the podcast, or I start a YouTube channel, or I'm making stuff. Like I'm trying to find something else that isn't involving technology. Like I say that, but like it's just
we're
I need technology to use it, but I'm not actually like
I used
not just
to
sit down doing nothing. I'm actually trying to be productive. I'm
doing stuff. And get your mind straight. Like I used to lie to myself, right? I haven't owned a laptop since 2009 was the last laptop I owned. Like this laptop isn't mine. This is work laptop. They gave it to me, but this is only used for work and things like this now. But I used to lie to myself and be like, I don't own a laptop. I don't spend too much time on these social media things. And then the phone became like, when did they get so smart? Like they do everything. Like this thing is never out of my hand. Like it's everything. It's me wallet. It's me fucking lifeline. Like,
I mean, like we, like
it kind of sounds like you're about to start trying to sell us your phone.
Have you seen the
you're
one
about to
plus
run an infomercial?
This is your lifeline.
I'm Troy McClure. You may remember me from such infomercials as
Get a flip phone, lads. I was going to there a couple of weeks ago. I was going to buy a flip phone.
Get a Nokia 3210. There you go.
I'd fucking love it. The 3310 was released. It just doesn't have WhatsApp on it, and I use WhatsApp a lot. Because everyone's cheap. They don't pay bills or buy credit anymore. It's let's use free WhatsApp.
Plug my phone in.
But it's, if you did get to 2 hours of this podcast,
congratulations.
I hope you enjoyed it. Tweet us if you did get that. At Fran310. I don't know the rest of your handles in and fuck.
No, but obviously, like, don't. Moral of the story is, and the rant, don't fall into the trap.
Don't fall into the trap.
Talk to people. And don't jump on the bandwagon. But
before you do get off Twitter, go to OTT Wrestling on Twitter. Find the GoFundMe for Ryan Smiles.
Yes.
Funeral. If you haven't already. Whatever that goes. If you haven't already. Throw money into that and then get the fuck off Twitter. Because mental health is important. You shouldn't be fucking around with that shit.
So
that's what I got for you.
I'm gonna try and end it on a positive, like more of a positive note and a lighthearted note.
Yeah.
As opposed to being very deep and
sorry, I dragged that down right there. That's,
don't worry, that's gonna be very interesting in a few weeks. But okay, we'll end it with this. Watching recommendations, because obviously with lockdown people are going to be looking for new programs or for new either podcasts or books. What are your recommendations going for
books?
You never know, people like to read.
Book recommendation, it's called Fucking Unstoppable by Paul Mort. It's very small, it's like it's not a struggle to actually read. Check it out at, I think it's paulmort.com. If you just look up Paul Mort, you'll be able to buy it online. You can't get an e-cents or anything like that. It's really cheap to get as well if you're stuck for money or anything like that. But it's a really, really good book. I've read 2 books, and that's one of them. And the other one is a finance book. Not good, well, it was good, but you wouldn't enjoy it. It's boring. But yeah, that's literally the only books I have. What about you, Joey? Do you read or do you do big pictures?
the only thing I read is Orla's homework, and I usually fuck that up. I don't know. I'm thinking about like getting Audible because I'm running out of podcasts to listen, so I might look into that. But as far as watching stuff, I know during lockdown one, I got through all the MCU. They're all on Disney Plus. So I got through all that and genuinely thinking about watching them again. Because Endgame, Infinity War, and anything to do with Captain America are just fucking superb.
I've never seen any of that.
Never seen any of the
Avenger lads.
There's so many of them as well. Like some of them you could probably skip, but like if you're a completionist, then you're gonna want to watch them all. I still haven't seen all the newer Spider-Man movies. I've seen Homecoming, but I haven't seen the other ones. But other than that, I started watching all of 2001 WWE. I don't know why. I just decided to one day and just started watching all of just like every Raw, every SmackDown, every pay-per-view.
Well,
I think it's just shit when I'm going to bed or like when I'm on my lunch break and walk. But I've gotten a newfound appreciation for the invasion angle. I don't think it was as bad as everyone made it out to be. Yeah, they didn't have the big stars, but like some of those lads were really trying. Like they were
they tried hard.
Yeah.
Like look at Buff Bagwell, he tried. He tried, but
he's still trying. Like,
there was some real shite. But like there was a handful of the boys that when they came in that took to the WWE style straight away. Like guys like Lance Storm and Billy Kidman and even like someone like Chuck Palumbo came in and just like, okay, well this is a lot better than how we were doing it. So
yeah, just let's keep going.
Look at the Hurricane.
Hurricane as well.
He's a nice man. Like,
jumped at it. But yeah, and like you see someone like DDP who came in and got absolutely jobbed out. Absolutely jobbed out from the second he walked in. But when you go back and watch it, like everyone complains about that like, oh my God, they jobbed out DDP. When you go back and watch it, he fucking deserved it. He sucked when he came in. He's like fucking falling all around the place like it's his first week in wrestling skill, which is
BRB.
Shocking. Like I like DDP. I loved him in WCW, but like he just anyway, I'm going off on one of him. But no, there's some really, really good stuff in 2001. Like it was a great year. The invasion angle wasn't as bad as everyone made it out to be.
I don't think it was. Like
I think it was just it wasn't what everyone expected it to be.
Yeah. Everyone was expecting the big names, but obviously, we didn't get that. We got like the lower class names that were available,
people that nobody knew.
Yeah.
But as far as like the in ring action and the people, like the efforts that they were making, it was actually really good.
Like two good pay per views, the invasion pay per view and the SummerSlam. Yeah, those two really stand out. Like, if you want good matches, go for RVD, Jeff Hardy. The two matches they had from Invasion and SummerSlam. Excellent. Excellent.
Well, I'll tell you what else it did as well, watching back through 01. It gave me I already liked The Rock, but I would always be, he's no Stone Cold. But when you go back, especially through this phase, through, like, 2000 into 2001, The Rock was on fucking fire. He'd work with anybody.
Yeah,
like there was a run there of just watching through them, and every week on Raw he's WCW champion, and every week on Raw he's defending the belt against somebody else. Like so he's got Lance Storm one week, he's got Rhino the next week, he's got fucking whoever comes up next, but like against Test and all, like, and he's having like 50-50 matches with them as well. Like he's not coming out and steamrolling them, like,
yeah,
kind of like the way Austin would have. It gives you a newfound appreciation for The Rock.
He was trying to put them over in the process, like get them over,
shine them up as much as he could in the 15 minutes that he had to do it, and they'd come out looking better from it. So, like, yeah, it's just, again, it is that, like I said a couple of minutes ago, it wasn't as bad as everyone said it was. It just wasn't what everyone was expecting it to be.
Yeah. No, you're completely right. Like obviously MCU is a great show for anyone to like start watching, especially with the lockdown. You need a long series of like films. Go find the book that Fran recommended. The one book.
It's called Fucking Unstoppable by Paul Mort.
Oh, and as well, if he's can find any of the Blind Boy books that he has out, his book on short stories.
Listen to the Blind Boy podcast. So good.
Yeah.
He recently had Sami Zayn on it for an episode.
I listened to that. It was really, really
I listened to that, and I listened to the Graham Norton one as well.
Graham Norton one. I did that on the same day. Yeah. Very good. We should have been tag partners. Should have been.
Yeah, we should.
Should have done that.
Still should. I'm not going to recommend anything. It's for you to like recommend. So, because mine be vastly underwhelming. But now, like, thank you, boys, for coming on. It's been fun.
Yeah, it's been good, crack.
It's been deep and.
You know me.
Borderline controversial.
A roller coaster.
Yeah. Borderline controversial, yeah. No, I didn't want that any of it.
It's been fun.
We're literally like, give it a week or so, and we are going to be asking the question, who the fuck is Fran Bork?
No. Don't cancel me. I didn't.
Not yet. Anyway. I'd like to thank. I can't even look at you now.
Who?
I'd like to thank Fran for coming on. I'd like to thank Terry Thatcher, aka Joey. it feels weird just calling you Joe, like on this. It does.
Shouldn't it feel weird for you to call me Terry? Because, like, you know, we've known each other for years.
I know, but when I know people like that are into wrestling are gonna be like listen to this, I do try to keep somewhat, and I still find it weird. Yeah.
Like, motherfucker, I'm your brother-in-law. Admit it, goddammit.
Accept me.
Notice me. they've been my guests for this episode. This has been the Foxy Bros podcast. Thank you, and we'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye.
Right.